Fantastic Bugsy McGraw.
And Crazy Bugsy is back with us, and you can see that knee is completely healed from the surgery he had on it. And Bugsy's at his best.
Yes, he is. Matt's Golden Boy Great down to the mat. Bugsy takes him now. Rams his head into the turnbuckle again. Rams it again.
Face full of turnbuckle for Mr. Gray's efforts here by Crazy Bugsy McGraw. And out of the ring goes Golden Boy Gray to the floor. Bugsy, wild as ever.
Right, slowly getting in. He's taking his time. He needs to take his time.
Bugsy McGraw, man, power house personified.
Yes, he right now. Backing into the corner. Great. Catching with the knee into the midsection. Trying his best to slow McGraw down. But can he do it?
Well, Gray is opening up the attack right now, David. And I'm afraid he might be getting himself in a lot of trouble because of Bugsy McGraw. Gets irritated. We've seen that happen with Bugsy and several people, one-man gang, particularly, you know, this man picked up that one-man gang, David.
That's right, he sure did.
450-some pounds. Bugsy had him up. He legitimately had him up. Hadn't been for Humperdinck right there. Bugsy, he had Slammed it over by Bugsy. Cut. Gray in a backdrop situation.
He's got him now. Hard. Left jabs. Lines up. Drops it.
Boom. And now it goes Gray. And Bugsy had a little dance there. He senses victory. Hard elbow really drops Gray. Bugsy right back in on top of him.
Takes him out, picks him up for that slam. Positions him. Does that little two-step around again. Comes across. Drops all of his weight down on top of him. And we have the winner.
We got a winner right here. What a stop, Golden Boy Gray. All the way. Red knocked out of him. Gray. Through the ropes here. We're going to see it again. A power to full body slam. Bugsy takes off of those ropes. And you see him with that Bugsy McGraw smash. The winner, Crazy Bugsy McGraw.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, remember, Harley Race. He does not like Ric Flair. He doesn't want any part of Ric Flair. He has a $25,000 bounty on Ric Flair. We have something about that bounty. Let's hear about it right now.
I didn't think that there was anything on the face of the earth that would ever push me to do what I'm going to do right now. But Flair, you have pushed me as far as you're going to push. Right here is $25,000. And it goes to any human being that can eliminate Ric Flair from wrestling. Take a look at it, Paul Jones, you and your whole entourage of people, Dick Slater, Kabuki, the names, the list, it goes on and on. Any human being that can eliminate Ric Flair for me has got $25,000 cash. I'll give it to any living human being.
We'll be back with more action right after this. There you see him, Bob Orton Jr. against Ben Alexander.
Bob Orton Jr.
This is some match.
One of the best around. What an athlete this young man is. He can do it all, David. He usually does in a match.
He definitely has. When you said he can do it all, he's got more moves. The guy, anytime he's so hard to defend against, John, I think that because he can move, he's got a different style of wrestling.
Fine headlock and takedown on Ben Alexander. Shows a lot of wrestling background and knowledge on by Bob Orton. Here was a counter by Alexander. Orton gets out of that right back to the headlock
And he continued to wear his man down, and he starts when that bell rings and methodically works on a man till he can wear him down. And he's got a lot of offensive weapons to put the man away, one being a superplex, where he gives a man a suplex off the top turnbuckle. Quite a magnificent feat, and it usually puts them right away.
Yes.
Not many have ever gotten up, and some have been carried out.
Yes, because he does a whip to that, and that really takes you down and rams you into that mat. All right, we're in the ropes now. Referee Stu Schwartz calls for the break, whips him across into the ropes. Good tackle by Orton. And Orton goes off again. Switch now, hip toss.
Boy, he's fast thinker, Bob Orton. One step ahead all the time. You know, one of his friends, a guy that he's been teaming up with a lot around lately, the Boogie Woogie Man, is going to be right here next week.
That's
so
great.
I know the fans don't want to miss the Boogie Woogie Man.
All right, but up coming in this hour, you're going to see the Assassins will be here. Mike Rotundo, plus Kabuki, the Magic Dragon, Ric Flair. Also, the Hammer, Greg Valentine, Ricky Steamboat, and more. Right here on Worldwide Wrestling. The very best. All right, Orton now has that front face lock. Switches quickly. All right, he's done. He's got the legs. He's got the arms with his legs.
He's got an arm scissored. He also has the other arm hooked, forcing both shoulders of Alexander to the mat. Alexander's spending a lot of energy trying to keep those shoulders off the mat, so he is a pin.
Right.
Now he's in a good situation. As you said, Bob Orton Jr. knows a lot about wrestling. He displays it in all his matches. I'm sure he has Ben Alexander thoroughly confused
right now. Look like they're in the ropes. Referee calls for the break.
A breaker, Orton, exactly.
Quickly gets away. He realizes he might be in trouble.
He never know what to expect from a Ben Alexander. Orton quickly away from him. He doesn't rush in, making mistakes.
All right, elbow in the back of the neck. Alexander is not sure which way he wants to go with Orton. He's trying to find that weak spot.
Right now he's going to open up the attack and see if that does any good for the offense. And Orton holds on the ropes, catches that elbow, smashes. Alexander hired. And down to the mat goes Ben Alexander. A good stop to the back of the head. Bob Orton Jr., he's up
on the road. Look at him walk the ropes.
Punch right to the forehead, staggers, and down goes Alexander.
Orton now taking his time. Drops the elbow to the back of the neck. Still has him. Bends him up. Ooh, look at that cross face. Cross face. He's got a cross face on that nose, just bending that nose around.
Nice switch it down on the chin. He has better leverage on the chin.
Pulling that hair, trying to get out of it. All right, also, Orton is cutting the wind off.
He's wearing him down, too. Also, David Alexander tried to open up the tack. It didn't faze Orton in the least. He fired right back, let Alexander know he wasn't going to get away with that.
Alexander, quick knees into the chest. Orton comes out with one right to the side of the head.
Alexander not expecting that. We really was dazed for that one. Orton moves in now. Whoa, what an uppercut. And the ropes is all that holds up Ben Alexander to present time in this match. Bob Orton Jr., he majors
him
up.
He's got him up.
Sets him on that top turnbuckle.
You were talking about it. That's super.
He set him up there. He gives him an elbow. And he almost out of ballpark.
Here it comes. You got him up. He's going to pick him up.
Top turnbuckle crashes down the winner, Bob Orton Jr.
Let's take time out for these commercial messages about the worldwide wrestling events coming up in your area.
Best in Wrestling, Friday, August 12th, 8:15 p.m., Hampton Coliseum. The Assassin, Dory Funk Jr. with Paul Jones, Dick Slater, Jack and Jerry Briscoe, Mike Rotundo, Rufus R. Jones, Ric Flair, Ricky Steamboat, Warhol McDaniel, and others. Great card at the Stafford Senior High School Gym, Fredericksburg, Virginia, on Thursday, August 11th. The Assassin, One Man Gang, Jack and Jerry Briscoe, Crazy Bugsy McGraw, Ricky Steamboat, Ric Flair, and others. Super. Card, Richmond Coliseum, Friday, August 19th. Listen to these stars. Dick Slater against Crazy Bugsy McGraw. TV title on the line. Kabuki with Gary Hart against Jimmy the Boogie Woogie Man Valiant. And for the World's Tag Team title, Jack and Jerry Briscoe against Ric Flair and Ricky Steamboat. Let's call him in right now. Dick Slater, you got Crazy Bugsy McGraw.
Well, you know, Bugsy McGraw is a little bit crazy. But Bugsy McGraw, you better realize you just came off an injury. And you don't think I'm not going to go after that, you're crazy yourself. Because I'm not really screwed on altogether there either. You know, I'm after a few things myself, and Bugsy McGraw, you may be in my way. But I know I'm going to be in for a good fight because I know Bugsy McGraw is going to get a little crazy. Well, I'll just get a little crazy back, Bugsy, and we'll just see who the better man is.
Let's call him in right now. TV title on the line. Kabuki with Gary Hart against the Boogie Woogie Man, Jimmy Valiant.
I've been thinking about Richmond, Virginia. I've been thinking about it a lot. I've been thinking about it so much. I've been thinking what happened to you the last time, Mike Rotundo, you little meatball that you are. I'm thinking about you, Jimmy Valiant. You know what else I'm thinking about, Jimmy Valiant? I'm thinking about how much I love having the national television champion. What else I'm thinking about, Jimmy Valiant? Thinking of campfires. There ain't gonna be no Boy Scouts sitting around.
World's Tag Team Championship. The champions, Jack and Jerry Briscoe against Ric Flair and Ricky Steamboat.
There comes a time in every man's life where he's got to stand up for himself. And Steamboat, you're falling a little bit short of standing up and facing the Briscoe brothers face to face. We took care of your little renegade partner, Jay Youngblood. We broke 52 of his ribs, and they're still counting the damage. You went out and you got yourself a $25,000 man. Brother, $25,000 can buy an awful lot of oranges, and we're going after it.
The Assassins, and what a tag team they are. They're against Mike Rotundo, Davis.
Oh, we see this. We've seen the Assassins now for several occasions, David, on Worldwide Wrestling. They're new to us. Their team is going to have to be reckoned with. They've showed a lot of ability, a lot of teamwork. One of them has really showed some feats of strength. We've seen him pick up a man 230 pounds, not from a standing position, but just right off the canvas, raise him high over his head to slam him down. And they work it.
John, the other one, the one in now, the stockier, the stouter of it.
But moves like a cat.
Yes, he
moves
does.
Like a cat. He's agile, nimble, quick, and they keep a man over their corner. They tag, and a lot of times, David, they tag legally.
Yes.
Fast, very fast, but they're tagging.
All right. Davis moves over.
And here's Mike Rotundo. Oh, beautiful drop kick. He's got it. Picks him up, goes for an arm.
They see that. The style was, he was blocking the move of Rotundo. Rotundo was trying it. He was a little bit too eager. The Assassin quickly. He crawls to his corner. Makes that tag.
Tag in there in the corner.
Rotundo needs to get
Mike
out of there.
Mike didn't
now.
See that either.
Hard fist to the head. Now, Rotundo trying to fight, but there, front face lock now. The Assassin taking the return quickly comes out.
Beautiful move.
Yes,
really a great counter by the youngster of Syracuse University who has a great knowledge of
John, the Assassin. No, he didn't want any part of it. Quickly got up off the mat. Goes out. Went out right above the ring to break that hole. Right now, move. No question now. They're talking back and forth. Talking to see what. All right, now they're in there. All right, catches him. Bends that arm. Makes the tag. Rotundo coming off that top rope. He made a legal tag. He got in before the count of five. He bends it. Still with the arm. Drops that leg across. Goes after him. The Assassin trying to keep that stiff arm so Rotundo can't bend it. Rotundo still has it right now. He's got it. Assassin tries.
Oh, and he hangs on.
Holds on to it.
Mike Rotundo, great wrestler. has an arm bar on the Assassin, and this man's an awful strong arm. He's got a hook right there, but the difference of knowledge of wrestling with can overcome that strength, and Mike Rotundo has rewrote the amateur wrestling books.
Good move by the Assassin. Tackle now. I just watched 2 minutes.
Whoa! Assassin down. He's going to make a tag, and now the team of Mike Davis and Mike Rotundo have got the Assassins over on their side of the ring, David.
That is right.
And this could really...
Yeah, but now, the thing is, the Assassin says they're a wrestling team. Let's see what type of team they are.
Well, let's see what they are.
Goes right back to the arm, John.
See how they maneuver against the team of Rotundo and Davis, because they have trapped them over in their corner. They have really upset their battle plan. Their battle plan has been to switch fast, keep the guy in their corner, which they have maneuvered him back there now. But for a while, that might be the weakness of the Assassin team.
And he tries to kick the Assassin off, which he does. Arm drag now. Cuts up with the arm bar.
All right, get him over to your corner, Mike.
All right, they're in the center of the ring, John. That's...
We're trying to throw off the battle plan of the Assassins. So far, it seems, if I was trying to look through it, David, is to keep them over in your corner because of the quick tags that they make. It takes so much toll off of their opponents. They can't tag out in that center or over in their side.
All right, really, they're jockeying back and forth. Assassin takes Rotundo, whips him across into the ropes.
Oh!
Tackle by Rotundo. Assassin catch, hip toss. What's going to happen?
Drop kick. By the Assassin, very good move. And Mike catches a drop kick. He's got to turn him over here with Russell Crab.
Busy.
Assassin, a lot of strength in the lower body. He's built very stocky, able to straighten those legs out, throw Mike off. He's going to make that tag now. What a great match so far. It's been back and forth. Nobody's had an advantage,
That's
David.
Right. The stronger of the two Assassins in right now, John. He takes a ton of whips him in. Remember, the back is hurt. The back is hurt. Rotundo stops him with a foot in the midsection still.
But the kid's got a lot of desire. Look at him fight back. Fight out of that corner. Assassin almost cuts him in two. With a shoulder right there.
Assassin now takes Rotundo. Got him.
Work on that back, David.
Yes, he is.
Oh!
That's
side suplex.
Right. He's got him now.
This Assassin is so strong, David. Yeah, but did you see how he got in there? He just scooped him off his feet and spun him into the corner. He's so strong, that Assassin. Now Mike, he's trying to get over towards Davis now. What an improvement Mike Rotundo has made the last year and a half in professional wrestling. He's wise enough. He knew he needed a tag, and he forced him over there until he got it. Davis said quickly, and he stays right on that attack, and they've really been taking it to the Assassins. He's going to get Rotundo back in. They're not going to give him a minute breather. Rotundo in quickly. He's against the Assassin. Good elbow, but look at the ring savvy of the Assassin. He got that elbow, fell, knew where his partner was, fell over there for a tag. Rotundo, though, doesn't
good
let up.
Rotundo now takes him, snap here, and takes that Assassin, goes for that pin. Didn't grab that leg. He should have an arm and leg. Got to hold on to it.
He got caught with a fist right there.
Takes him now. Whips him across into the ropes.
Rotundo ducks down here. Comes across body block. We could have a winner right here.
No, quick tag. Good move by Rotundo. Davis is in there. He's got him going. Comes across.
Hold the
shots.
Let's see what this has to maneuver now is. They got Davis in trouble. He goes, slams him on that arm in a hammerlock position.
All right, here it goes, John. They're going tagging in and out. They're working on their opponent. They said they're a wrestling machine. They know
another
how
body slam with that arm they in that hammerlock position. And now here's the favorite maneuver of the Assassins. We've seen them do
Vegas. Dropping knees on that arm. Tagging that wristband in. I know this is irritating the fans and us who watch it, David, but
it's legal.
They are tagging legal.
It is a legal move.
Sticks that arm up. We could have a winner. Mike Davis submits to him. They keep dropping that knee, keep dishing out that punishment. Mike Davis.
And we'll be back with more action right after this.
Able to breathe. Are you be able to talk some more, Ric Flair? You know, $25,000 is a lot of money. And there's a lot of bad people in this world like me. And I'm not going to implicate Paul Jones, but I know Paul Jones would like $25,000. And I know Greg Valentine would like $25,000. And I know that I'm going to collect that $25,000 because I know Harley Race is going to keep the world's heavyweight championship. Unless it's somebody like me or one of your men or Greg Valentine that takes it away from him. But I'm going to take the $25,000 and it's going to be right in the bank because I will beat up anybody that tries to collect it themselves. Excuse me.
Well, you know something, Dickie. Guys like you, Greg Valentine, and my two men, Ric Flair cannot sleep at night for the simple fact is he knows that he can never turn his back because $25,000 is a lot of money. I don't care who it is. Now, Ric Flair, when you wake up in the morning, you better look behind you because it might be Valentine, it might be Slater, it might be Jake Roberts, or it might be Dory Funk Jr.
I'll tell you what, Paul, I'm just glad I'm not in Ric Flair's shoes. He's got a lot of top wrestlers, a lot of mean, tough, hungry individuals after $25,000, including myself. But I'm not just after $25,000. I want to keep my United States title. I don't want to have to wrestle maniacs like Roddy Piper anymore. I had the man suspended. And now he had the suspension uplifted, all of a sudden Piper's running around free again. Well, a man like this that conducts himself in this manner shouldn't be in professional wrestling today. And Ric Flair, Roddy Piper, you're going to end up in the same place, out of wrestling.
There you see it. That kick by Kabuki, and what a team this is. Kabuki the Magic Dragon, we've seen the Assassins. There's so many good teams right now.
And this Kabuki and the Magic Dragon, David, a team from Asia, and their offense and defense is all together different, so it makes it a complicated job to have to go in there and wrestle these guys. And also in the corner of the picture, leading up against the post, see one ball hit an individual out there by the name of Jerry Hart. The Magic is a great Asian team of Kabuki and the Assassins.
The manager, Gary Hart, when you think about him, you have to think about another individual because when you, it's just like ham and eggs. You got to talk about Jimmy Vaillant and Gary Hart.
Two drop kick.
Rick Picard in the ring catches Kabuki and drops him with a drop kick. Gets caught with a karate kick and again, Kabuki takes over. Now here quickly in the ring. Look at this maneuver. Handle when you're going against a team of Kabuki and the Magic Dragon. Talk about right. The unexpected, David.
That's
that
right.
Is an unexpected
yes, it
maneuver
is.
To have
right,
to
try to jump. Before goes down for the pin, almost. That's that kick. When you fight Kabuki, you can't just worry about the hands. You've got to worry about his feet too. All right, the Magic Dragon kicks the cord right in the midsection. Takes him in.
The Asian team has so many unexpected things they can throw at you during the course of the match. It really keeps you confused with trying to set your own game plan. Now I see Kabuki getting a few words to Gary Hart in the corner. And we speak of Gary Hart, a manager. We have another manager who will be with us next week.
That's right. Paul Jones. And he still calls himself Paul Jones number one because he thinks he's the number one manager.
And now, the infamous Dream Contest and the incident that happened with the Dream Contest with Rufus R. Jones.
Yes.
And it's boiling into quite a feud between those two.
That's right. It'd be nice to see Rufus and Jimmy Van to get together and clean all these managers out.
Well, Valiant has made a statement that Woogie Man usually gets done what he says. He's going to rid the area of the managers. He was starting to start with Humperdinck to go right to Hart after that, and I'm sure he'd be looking at Paul Jones down the line. So the managers, well, anybody that's got the Woogie Man has been having a lot of trouble.
Yes, they are.
As Rick McCord is having right now with the team of Kabuki and the Magic Dragon, because they are,
top and bottom.
They stirred in. They got those karate thrust in the stomach and in the chest, and he's going to fight back. Well, no, he's not going to get away from Kabuki. And he keeps him right into that corner, their old corner. Also, Gary Hart over there. And, you know, the manager out there, David, even if he doesn't do anything, he's always present. And you've got to keep that in your mind that he could, even if he doesn't.
That's right, John. All right, Cord trying to fight his way. Trying to fight his way out of it. Can he make it? Rolls over, makes that tag now. Him across.
Mistake right there in their corner. It's that kick.
A hot kick. Makes the tag to the Dragon.
Look at Kabuki. Claw.
All right, the chop into the head goes to the claw.
We got a winner right there. He forced him down on that with that claw, and he's going to hang on to it, David. Gary Hart going to try to restrain him. Team now as a victory is scored by Kabuki with that claw. There you see it.
He grabbed it. He chopped it and ran it.
Got those weird fingers in the way. It really helped.
And you win. Kabuki and the Magic Dragon with Gary Hart. We'll be back with more action right after this. World Heavyweight Champion Harley Race. He's in trouble by you, Ric Flair. You have that sleeper on him.
Well, that's right, David. At this point in the match, and I want to thank you and your brother and everybody out there that's responsible for letting me come on the air with this particular tape to show the whole wrestling world exactly what's going on between Race and I and this $25,000 bounty. Now, I had Harley Race in the sleeper. He went to throw my head into the rope. I pushed him in the turnbuckle. When he came out, I gave him a back suplex. Now, I'm going to work on his leg right here with the hopes of getting the figure four on him.
All right, Rick, you're still working on that leg. You haven't, you've already set your game plan. You want Harley Race, you're gonna try to put that figure four on him. That's your best hold.
Well,
you
know, David, I've spent years and months trying to perfect that hold, and it's just been in the last 6 months that I've really learned the secret of keeping someone from turning it over and keeping someone from getting to the ropes once I get it on him in the middle of the ring. My strategy when I went into the ring with Harley Race in this particular match was to work on his legs, look for an opening, and hopefully have an opportunity to put the figure four on. Now, as you'll see later on in this match, I had that opportunity. I got the figure four on Harley Race. And the reason I'm standing out here and the reason I've asked you and your brother and Crocker Promotions for the time on this program, because I wanted to show the people just how serious Harley Race is about the $25,000 bounty. You know, you hear a lot of people talk about money and what they can do with it and what they can't do with it. Well, Harley Race wants to keep that World Heavyweight Championship at all costs, David. He's actually put a $25,000 bounty on me to any wrestler walking the streets, any wrestler walking anywhere in the world, to eliminate me from professional wrestling, which means eliminating me from the title picture. Yeah.
Are you that snapmare? On Race, you back up. You are excited.
I'm real excited.
Hard. I just down got across that head.
That's right. Now, Harley Race has got one of the hardest heads of any man I've ever been in the ring with.
The figure four. That is your hold.
That's
it. He knows that. He had that radar feature.
I had an opportunity to apply it to him, but I didn't have him in the middle of the ring. got to the ropes before I actually had it on. At this point in the match, as I said earlier, we've been wrestling for some time. It's taken a toll on both of us. I'm not going to sit here and try and tell you or anybody else that Harley Race is a real man. He's been a world champion 7 times. However, this last trip around, he was lucky and he was fortunate. He got the count and I didn't. Now at this point in the match, he's come out of the floor. He's tried to brain me with a chair. You see right here, I take a chair away from him and boom, I load the boom on him, brother. Because I know the race is going to be me bodily harm, and in turn, anyone that tries to hurt me is going to pay the price, because I might come at them with everything I have. Now, Wraith suffered a cut on his head from the blow by the chair. I just ran him in the post. At this point in the match, the tide is turning in favor of myself. I'm going to bring him in the ring right here. And from this point on, David, as I said, I'm working towards the figure four. He's in bad shape. I'm going to drop a big elbow on his head right here. Matt should have got the count right there. But you see what he does? 1, 2, and his foot made it over the rope. Okay, he saved himself there. But David, I smelled victory. I was very close. And when I got on top of him right here, I lowered the boom on him with everything I had. And yes, I'm excited. You can see the way I'm going around that ring. I like excitement. I like competition. I like knowing, and I know when I'm close to victory. Now, Harley Race is mine, and I'm giving him my best shot right here, David. My best shot. As you can see, I'm not cutting him any slack at all. I'm chopping him. I'm punching him. I'm going after the World Heavyweight Championship the only way I know how, and that's all out. My big vertical suplex, and you know what's next, David. I'm going for the figure four. He's in the middle of the ring. I've got him weakened, and here it is. The figure four, and brother, special referee Sandy Scott right there knows that I've got him in a bad way. Race can't turn it over. He can't take it to the ropes. Now we're talking about $25,000. We're talking about a bounty. And watch what Dick Slater does. In a very short period of time, he's going to come running in the ring. There he is right there. Cowboy boots, jeans. He nails Sandy Scott from behind. And watch what he's doing. He's stomping me in the head, about to throw the chest with cowboy boots. That's okay, David. Because Slater, not to be preoccupied with you at this point in time, remember one thing. Payback is with Slater. Now, several wrestlers tried to come into the ring right here at this point and help me. They were unsuccessful. It's no discredit to them because Race and Slater are two very dangerous and very tough men. But when they got rid of these guys, you see what they can do to me right here. Race grabs me from behind, locks my head in one position. Slater runs all the way across the ring, kicks me in the head with cowboy boots on. Now, if that's not trying to collect some money and trying to do some damage to me, I don't know what is. You can see I'm in a bad way right there. Race holds me. Slater's punching me. Here comes another one of the guys to try and help me. Race actually backhands him across the face. You'll see Slater drop a cowboy boot on my head again right there. Now, Slater's going to wheel around, and he's going to the bank. At least he thinks he is. They pick me up at this point and give me a double suplex, which in itself, and thank God I'm here to talk about it, could have caused me bodily damage. Slater is pounding me with his best shot right here. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I want to say one thing. My name is Ric Flair, and I've been the world champion. I've tasted the good life. I've tasted everything that professional wrestling can give a man. The only thing now I haven't tasted is Dick Slater's sweat and blood. The Briscoes, Slater, fuck, it makes no difference. You see the scar? I don't care. Because in my language, come and get it, Daddy, because I'm going to be waiting. And David, woo, you know what I'm talking about.
There he is, Ric Flair.
Let's take time out for these commercial messages about the worldwide wrestling events coming up in your area.
Fans, the Vic Hampton Coliseum will be the scene of the best in wrestling on Friday, August the 12th at 8:15. The Assassin, Dory Funk Jr. with Paul Jones. You'll see Dick Slater, Jack and Jerry Briscoe, Mike Rotundo, Rufus R. Jones, Ric Flair, Ricky Steamboat, Muhammad Daniel, and others. Now let me tell you about a great card at the Stafford Senior High School gym, Fredericksburg, Virginia. That's on Thursday, August the 11th. You're going to see The Assassin, One Man Gang, Jack and Jerry Briscoe, Crazy Bugsy McGraw, Ricky Steamboat, Ric Flair, and others. Super spectacular card, Richmond Coliseum. Write this date down. Friday, August the 19th. You're going to see Dick Slater against Crazy Bugsy McGraw. TV title, Kabuki with Gary Hart against Jimmy, the Boogie Woogie Man Valiant. And for the World's Tag Team title, Jack and Jerry Briscoe against Ric Flair and Ricky Steamboat. Let's call him in now. Crazy Bugsy McGraw.
You see, because you hear a lot of things about so-and-so is crazy, and Dick Slater's unpredictable, and he might be crazy, too. Well, really, it all boils down to a situation. What really makes you crazy, understand? Is it drugs? Is it alcohol? Is it sex? Or maybe your divorce you just had? Maybe that might drive you crazy, too. Well, we're going to find out just how crazy you can get. I swear to God, Richmond, I will be there.
Let's call him in. The Boogie Woogie Man, Jimmy Valiant, goes for that TV title against Kabuki with Gary Hart.
Woo! We did it, people! We did it! We did it! I said I'll go get rid of the managers! We did it! Hump a dig! Bye-bye! And we kept the one-man gas here! I said I'm gonna do it! We did it! Well, this time I want to say, Mr. Gary Hart, Mr. Hump a dig, for burning the Boogie Man, for taking a TV title, I'm gonna give it back to you. Woo! Feel good! Feel good!
These two gentlemen, Ric Flair and Ricky Steamboat, go for the World's Tag Team Championship against Jack and Jerry Briscoe.
You know something, Briscoes? Can you put a value, can you put a price on friendship? I mean, good, close friendship. You can't do that. Can you put a price, can you put a value on a man's word of honor? You can't. This man has given me that, his word of honor to be my partner. Now, you talk about the $25,000 that you want from this man's head. I'm giving him my word of honor that you're going to have to go through me if you want to collect.
Richmond's the place. If the Briscoes want it, we're not hard to find. We'll be right in the middle of the ring. Come on in, Daddy, and go for it.
We'll be there.
Woo!
Raw savage power.
Listen exactly. Listen to the fans. I know. They want Piper. They want Piper to get the man out there. You're looking at him. The Hammer Greg Valentine.
And I don't know for sure if he wants Roddy Piper anymore, David. The way that Piper, well, we saw him drop the rope around his neck a little bit. Burned him real bad, too.
Oh, he did.
Of course, Roddy has been questioned about that. Will be suspended if he does that again. But he's not going to give up because he's the man that was hurt by Piper and by Valentine. And he's out to get that title from Valentine and hurt him if he can in the process.
Yes. You just don't know what this does to Valentine when you fans out there are screaming at him. It completely confusing because he thinks that Piper might be out in the crowd. He knows he's somewhere around. That Piper was suspended. He's back from suspension because he just literally tried to hang Greg Valentine.
Well, so far against Bret Hart in this match, Valentine might have been upset by the chanting of the fans here, but he is now methodically went about his wrestling the same way he has always, and he is just methodically taking it right to Bret Hart. You notice how Valentine is his own style moves, and he's going to step in now.
Right, he's got it.
It's his time.
All right, he's got him up. Got him.
Oh!
Almost. Cut him in half.
Again, our fans are going.
Listen to him.
Listen. We want Piper. There you see him.
Boy, they're
enjoying themselves out there and quickly grabbing a hold is Greg Valentine. Is anything to quiet that down? Valentine to ring better than he knows is to grab
John, look, punches look at, the ball. He's yelling, stop. Valentine, you saw his voice, he said, stop.
He grabs a hold and punishes him. That quiets the fans down at the for the moment. The game plan is right back into Valentine's favor. He takes his time and he just destroys his opponent.
And that he can do. Look what he did. Look what he did to Roddy Piper. Piper was out of action. He's lost part of his hearing. Again, they started it up again. Now he's got hit that headlock. Put the front. Oh! Roddy, right in the back of the neck with that forearm.
Just about the time Bret Hart was about to build his confidence, Valentine turns the tables, and now he's...
What's he going
to
do?
Drops his throat right across that top rope, David, and there's no way for Bret Hart to move his head or anything. It wasn't designed to bend in that direction. He was maybe hurt after that one.
Right there. That elbow in the back of the neck. He takes
Bret Hart tumbles through the ropes, and that's not a good place to be.
No, what?
With Greg Valentine, neither of you turn you around.
Here comes Hart.
Oh, you can hear that punch all over our auditorium here. And down to the concrete floor goes Bret Hart. Bret Hart, young wrestler, got a big future. He's got a lot of heart, a lot of desire,
yes,
this
look
kid.
At
he won't quit.
Oh, nice.
He stuns Valentine, doesn't move him far. Valentine right on top of the situation. Oh, comes back with a big elbow. Whoa!
Valentine bends him back.
Here comes the hammer. Nope, an elbow. Bret Hart a little bewildered. Of course, he's never probably been in there against a hammer.
Bret tried to get, look at, he wants, he's getting back in. Bret Hart trying to fight it back.
Fans again start that staccato chant. We want Piper. Valentine quickly snatches a hold, takes the youngster down in the middle of the ring, trying to quiet that crowd down. You know, David, in a situation Bret Hart's in right here, I know the fans are hollering, we want Piper to distract Valentine, to worry Valentine, but it's got to be a little disheartening for Bret Hart, too, to be in there trying his best, and he is. He's
good.
And a fine maneuver there by Bret Hart.
But
he gets overconfident. Rush in. Now Valentine's too ring-wise for it.
Yeah, because that drop kick didn't hurt Valentine as much. But Valentine saw it. He started backpelling. All right, Bret now, forearms right to the chest. He takes Valentine, bends that arm, whips him across into the turnbuckle.
Valentine looking
too
way
smart.
Ahead,
Valentine's
looking for an opening.
Too smart. Valentine.
Reverse right. Atomic drop.
Just about everything the Valentine's done.
Goes to the leg, and here's a man that's been dangerous on legs.
He broke Wahoo's
leg.
Half
crab right here. This could be a submission. Valentine has taken his toll on legs of wrestlers.
Oh, look, he's got that way
half crab, and he's pouring, cranking on the punishment. I think he's amazed that Bret Hart hasn't given up yet. He has yes, now. We've got a winner right here.
The Hammer Greg Valentine, the United States Heavyweight Champion. What a man he is.
With the half crab. Valentine stands in the center of the ring over his fallen opponent. Listen to the crowd.
Look at it. Look at him. Has it. Look at it. Look at the effort he's got behind that.
He really puts a lot of effort into that whole forcing the submission by Bret Hart. The winner, the United States Heavyweight Champion, Greg the Hammer Valentine.
All right, Greg, how is Jay?
I know that's a big question in everybody's mind. We have a lot of fan mail coming in about the injury of Jay Youngblood. Ladies and gentlemen, he's going to be out for 3-4 weeks. He's got some cracked ribs around the area and right here. He's not out permanently. He's just, it's a kind of injury in which you just can't wrestle. And the Briscoes have been saying, who am I going to get for a partner now? I'm backed up against the wall. I'm alone right now. I'm sure the people have seen what Ric Flair has offered his services. And there's a man right there, $25,000 bounty, offering to help me. I didn't ask him. He came up and asked me. And I know he's got other obligations, so I'm looking for some other partners. I'm looking for some other help.
You're looking for other partners?
Yes, I think there's
a man standing over here, right?
Come on in here. You're looking for partners, yes, sir.
I'll tell you what, if I ain't got no fight with Valentine, who's first on my mind, I'll be your partner anytime. If we could get yourself, if we could get the Briscoes all in the same ring, if we could get Valentine, get Flair, get yourself,
get
myself, get everybody in the ring at the same time, just like you see. Look at, take a shot of all these folks right here. Take a look at these people right here, man. You get all these, we'll put everybody in the ring all at the same time, you see? And then what we'll do is we'll eliminate them and give you Briscoes all by yourself.
This is the kind of help that I've needed. The Briscoes have said, who can I get? They say Flair's tied up over here. Piper's tied up with Valentine over there.
That's the Briscoe saying that.
Yeah, that's what they're saying.
Yeah.
But this man just said it on TV.
You know
that if he has any openings in his contract dates without Valentine, that he would be glad to be my partner. God almighty, probably that's what I need some help, and they're coming up and helping me.
It's as simple as this, you know. Briscoes have been around, and they're talking about Steamboat and Youngblood and Piper and Flair being has-beens.
Oh, yeah.
Well, there's a little story that goes along with that. He said there was two bulls standing on top of the hill, big bulls. You see, they're standing, and they're looking down at all these cows. Now, one bull's old and been there, and one bull's young and hasn't. And the young bull says, why don't we run down there and get us one of them cows? And the old bull says, why don't we walk down there and get a date with all of them cows? You see, what we're talking about is why don't we walk down there and take care of them all at the same time in one little funnel? It'd be simpler, wouldn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So we're talking if the Briscoes want to get Slater, that's fine. If the Briscoes want to get Valentine.
Oh, wouldn't that be nice?
Oh.
That'd be fine.
Oh,
that'd be lovely.
And they're talking about even bring Hurley Race in if they want to.
$25,000.
They put on Flair's head, huh?
Yeah, it's as simple as that.
I said, Hurley, Flair's told me last time that he would be my partner. Any bounty you set in the ring during our match, you're going to have to go through me. And I'm sure this man feels the same way.
Oh, bounty hunters went out a long time ago, Jack. We're going to watch everybody's back. We got policemen at the door. We got midgets and leathers. We got giraffes. We got everything we need to take care of the situation.
This is 1983, right?
1983. Yes, bounty hunters are dead, Jack. So you go ahead and break Flicka down. But you're looking at a couple men that ain't afraid of nothing, man.
I feel so much better now. I've got Piper and Flair's come out. Two great guys. We're going to get them.
1983.
Let's see you next week right here on The Mess. Worldwide Wrestling.
Worldwide Wrestling has been furnished to this station for broadcast at this time by Jim Crockett Promotions in exchange for a commercial consideration.
Show.